I would like to invite our second speaker. She's Silvia Vincenzi. She has a PhD scholar at the University of Tasmania in Australia. And we will post some information to Richard on Twitter and also her first author paper that she has been recently published. So congratulations for that. And I would also like to mention that she is looking for a postdoc position. So if someone is looking for a brilliant postdoc, maybe it's the time to listen to this talk. And so please, Sylvia, the floor is yours.
Hi, can you all see my screen, right?
Yes, that's
Yeah,
fine.
I was trying to get the laser pointer, but I can't, but I'll be right. Okay, so thank you, Alberto, for the nice introduction. And also I would like to thank NeuroMatch Conference for giving me the opportunity to present my first author publication, which is entitled Serotonin Functions as a Bidirectional Guidance Molecule Regulating Growth and Motility. And so, as you might already understand from my title, mine is a neurodevelopmental story, which is driven by serotonin. And so let's see why serotonin. Well, okay, we start. I have to find. I cannot see my mouse. Sorry, guys. Okay. So maybe I can use the laser point. Okay. Sorry for the start. Okay.
No problem.
So serotonin, I guess it doesn't really need too much of an introduction, as I believe that you are all aware that serotonin is a neurotransmitter in the mature brain and is therefore regulating most of our body functions, mood, and social behavior, such as appetite, digestion, sleep, memory, neuronal cognition, but is also implicated in a wide range of mental health disorders, including anxiety and depression. And so when you have depression, you get prescribed with antidepressants, and the most commonly prescribed class of antidepressants is SSRI. That stands for selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. And so, as I already suggest from the name, their job is to increase the level of serotonin in the brain. And that's all good, except for when pregnant women get prescribed with SSRI, because these drugs have been shown that not only permeate the placenta, but they can also permeate the developing fetal blood-brain barrier. And so you will not only have increased level of serotonin in the mother's body, but also in the fetal brain. And so the consequence for that have been shown that the newborn could really have an increased risk of developing autism spectrum disorder. So these studies really suggest that a dysfunction in serotonin signaling during these early stages of brain development can then contribute to the onset of neurodevelopmental disorder. So the question is how is it possible that a well-established neurotransmitter in the mature brain can also affect brain development and circuit formation? Well, interesting is that serotonin is one of the first neurotransmitter systems to emerge in the developing brain, as it is synthesized by serotonergic neurons that cluster together at the level of the brave nuclei, from where they spread this massive axonal projection throughout the nervous system. And so they are believed to release serotonin to all these brain regions prior to the formation of most conventional synapses. And so the fact that serotonin is present that early in development before neuronal circuits become fully functional, it's what really led us to hypothesize that perhaps serotonin plays a non-canonical role prior to functioning as a neurotransmitter. So what could be this role? Well, as you might be aware of, brain circuit formation occurs through a process known as axon guidance, during which a neuron extends a protrusion called an axon that navigates in the environment until it reaches and connects with their synaptic target. And to do so, its leading tip, called the growth cone, is continuously sampling the environment, looking for signal to instruct him where to go. And those instructing signal is what we call guidance cues. And so that's what we hypothesized. Perhaps we said, well, if serotonin is there in the environment before the formation of conventional synapses, then perhaps it's acting as a guidance cue molecule and therefore instructing the growth cone where to go to reach and connect with their precise targets. And so how do we test this hypothesis? In my study, we decided to use dorsal root ganglia sensory neurons in cultures coming from embryonic Sprague Dawley rat. And I test the growth cone motility with the Moomin Poo in vitro growth cone turning assay. So for the people who are not familiar with the assay, I'll briefly explain. Essentially, I select isolated growth cone in cultures and expose them to asymmetric gradients of serotonin that comes from the pulsatile ejection from a micropipette located at 80 micron away at a 45 angle. And essentially what I do, I just measure whether the growth cone is growing towards the pipette, that's what we call growth cone attraction, or is growing away from the pipette, that's what we call growth cone repulsion. And this measurement comes from the turning angle. So I'll show you here based on the control. So the first condition, the vehicle is the negative control, which we are not expecting elicit any turning, and indeed the angle of turning is zero, which simply means that the growth cone has been growing straight. Then I use two positive controls, BDNF and SEMA, where BDNF acts as an attractive guidance cue inducing growth cone attraction, as indicated by the positive angle of turning, which means the growth cone has been growing towards the pipette. And then SEMA that acts as a repulsive guidance molecule that induces growth cone repulsion, as indicated here by a negative angle of turning, and therefore the growth cone has been growing away from the pipette. So next, I'm investigating the effect of serotonin on turning based on its concentration. And so from this data, essentially, what I found is that only two concentrations were sufficient to elicit significant turning in growth cones. Specifically, I have 50 micromolar serotonin that for the rest of the talk I refer to as 5-HT low has been eliciting growth cone attraction, which is indistinguishable from BDNF. And then the second concentration, 100 micromolar serotonin that I will be referring to as 5-HT high, has been induced growth cone repulsion. And so here is the question is like, how is it possible that the same molecule is able to elicit two distinct growth cone behaviors? Well, we hypothesize that perhaps different receptors are responsible for mediating these opposite growth cone responses. So let's go and see which receptor are playing a role. So I first decided to treat or discover what's going on in the growth cone attraction induced by 5-HT low. And we found out that serotonin receptor 2A is the receptor that is mediating the 5-HT low induced growth cone repulsion attraction. So you can see here, I just confirmed the presence of the receptor with immunocytochemistry in growth cone. They have this punctate distribution. And then is the receptor also functional? To test this, we decided to use an approach using pharmacology. And so to test whether the receptor is playing a role, I simply stimulated the receptor with the agonist TCB2. And you can see here that the application of TCB2 in the pipette induced growth cone attraction, which is indistinguishable from the growth cone attraction induced by 5-HT low. What happened instead if we are blocking the receptor with the antagonist retansering. So we are preventing 5-HT low from the binding to 5-HT2A. And you see that the application, the BATH application of retansering abolished completely the growth cone attraction induced by 5-HT low. And the same can be said when we're using other two drugs that are playing a role downstream the signaling pathway of 2A. So for instance, U73122 is an inhibitor of phospholipase C, while instead tapsigagin is an inhibitor of the CERCA pump located on the endoplasmic reticulum and therefore is depleting DR from calcium. And so you can see that the BATH application of both the drugs in conjunction with 5-HT low in the pipette was sufficient to abolish the growth cone attraction induced by 5-HT low. And so this is a really nice demonstration to show how targeting the pathway upstream at the level of the receptor or downstream at the level of the different intracellular signaling path players was really sufficient to show that 5-HT2A is the receptor that mediates growth cone attraction induced by 5-HT law. And because you see that here, the downstream player that is downstream 5-HT2A signaling is calcium released from the endoplasmic reticulum, I then moved on performing calcium imaging in growth cone. And what you can see here, at least from this figure and this graph, is that at 5 minutes, when I start puffing 5-HT low from the pipette, as you can see here from the blue line, calcium is not only increasing over time intracellularly, but is also increasing first on the side of the growth cone that is facing the source of 5-HT low. And so this is another just confirmation of the fact that 5-HT2A is mediating 5-HT low induced growth cone attraction. Okay, so now that we unravel the attraction, what about the repulsion? So to unravel what's going on in the repulsion, I used a similar approach for the attraction. So again, I confirmed the presence of the receptor 5-HT1B on growth cones, which is the one that we suspect in playing a role in the repulsion. And again, it's showing this punctate distribution throughout the growth cone. And again, I started with activating the receptor with the agonist CP94253. And you can see that the activation of the 5-HT1B with the agonist was sufficient to elicit growth cone repulsion, which again is undistinguishable from the growth cone repulsion induced by 5-HT high. What happened if we block the receptor with the antagonist GR5562? So by preventing the binding of 5-HT high to the receptor with the antagonist, we were able to abolish the growth cone repulsion induced by 5-HT high. Okay, and then following, the same can be said when we instead are using, we are rescuing cycling MP signaling with forskolin and SPCAMP. Again, you can see here that we can abolishing the growth cone repulsion induced by 5-HT high. And because the downstream signaling pathway here is mediated by lower level of cycling MP, I then moved on and performed cycling MP imaging to look at the levels of cycling MP in growth cones. So I use here a construct that you need to get your head around, because this construct works that when there are a decreased levels in cycling MP, you will have an increase in fluorescence readout, which is exactly what you can see here from this figure and this graph with the, and if you follow the orange line, which is the cycling MP changes in growth cone exposed to 5-HT high, they show this increase of fluorescence readout, which really indicates a decreased level on cycling MP. And also can be seen here by these growth cone, that this growth cone is not only turning away from 5-HT high gradients, but is also showing increased intensity of pixel. Okay, so in summary, I hope I convinced you today that serotonin can act as a dose-dependent manner to activate growth cone attraction and repulsion by activating distinct receptors that then are mediated by distinct second messengers. And so, yeah, so we not only like now unraveled that serotonin can act as a guidance cue, but we also unraveled the, let's say, molecular mechanism underpinning this 5-HT induced bidirectional turning. And we hope that this will help us to better understand disorders that are caused by the incorrect fine-tuning of circuits that probably are underpinned by the dysregulation of 5-HT signaling, such as autism. So I'd like just to thank you all for listening. Again, thanks NeuroMatch for giving me the opportunity to present my PhD project, and my lab, my supervisor, PhD brothers and sister, collaborators that have always been really supported during my PhD, the funding bodies, and I'm happy to take any questions or even try. I'm always happy if you try to reach out to me, even in the future, through my Twitter or email. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Silvia. A very interesting talk and a lot of experiments that you did. And we have a question from Shooting. Great talk. I agree. How is this serotonin mediated attraction and repulsion involved in serotonin pathology like depression? Any related phenotype and mechanism?
Thank you, Shooting, for your question. I am mostly in my PhD, or at least in my personal, I'm mostly interested in neurodevelopmental disorders rather than depression. So, for neurodevelopmental disorders such as autism, sometimes they're believed, like all these disorders are believed to be generated by the incorrect fine-tuning of neuronal circuits. And so, hypothetically, if you think perhaps is a growth cone that took the wrong direction, so instead of going right, could have been going left, to make it really simple. And so, by having these dysregulation levels of serotonin, and if I have to give like an explanation, a physiological explanation, the fact that it's going attraction or repulsion depending on the levels, it really make me believe that perhaps undertaking antidepressants during pregnancy, you are increasing the level of serotonin. So in the fetal brain, you have increased level of serotonin. You have increased serotonin levels, and therefore it could be that the growth cone or the axons are wiring in a different way, and therefore targeting a different partner. And so that's how you give rise to slightly different neuronal circuits. Because you, when you are on autism, you are on a spectrum, as it mentioned, like already the disorder. So it makes sense to me that you are not necessarily wrong. You're just a different, you're activating or you're giving rise to a different circuit that then later on in life appear to, be involved in some cognitive behavior, such as perception, problem solving, decision making, and judgment. So I hope I answered your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Silvia. We have a question from the audience from Lei. She asks, have you looked at the HTR2A pathway activation with high concentration of serotonin? Do you think these two different receptor-mediated pathways are activated exclusively?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your question. I actually, yeah, I'm glad that you asked this question because this is just one tenth of all the experience I've been doing. I'll just show you straight the 2A1B because it came out after many tests. I tested each concentration. I tested also with the opposite receptor. So what you ask me, yeah, I tested the 2A with the 5-HT high and the 1B with the 5-HT low. I even tested 5-HT3 and the downstream also 5-HT4. And essentially, like this is what it suggests. I actually perform even more experience because when I when I reached this point that you, if you can still see this slide, I was really thinking, well, how is it possible that the growth cone can really switch from attraction to repulsion over such a narrow concentration of serotonin? And I was asking myself, is it a matter of maybe receptor affinity or receptor density, or is it a matter of spatial and temporal reorganization of serotonin receptor in motile growth cones? So it came out that for the attraction, it can be explained that essentially 5-HT low is recruiting 5-HT2A on the near side of the growth cone facing the source of serotonin. While on the other hand, with the repulsion, it seems like that 5-HT2A get desensitized. So essentially, when you are increased the level of serotonin, 5-HT2A gets desensitized and doesn't function anymore. So that's why you don't see any responses. And that's what we think is that the signal gets spill over onto 5-HT1B, which takes over and drives the repulsion through the cyclin AMP signaling. Thank you. I hope I answered the question, and if not, I'm happy to speculate more.
Thank you. I think so, but I think otherwise you can also continue to exchange messages while we continue with our next speaker. So thank you again, Silvia.
Thank you.
Our next and last speaker.